So moving on to question number 49, straight away to the question paper, full revision paper on AC, question number 49. A series LCR circuit is connected to an AC source, 200 volts, 50 hertz. The voltage across resistor, capacitor, inductor are respectively 200, 250 and 250. The algebraic sum of voltages across the three elements is greater than the voltage of the source. How is this paradox resolved? We have done this question already, but I'm doing it again. Given the value of resistance of RS, 40 ohm, calculate the current in the circuit. So what does the question say? A series LCR circuit. So series LCR circuit. Look at this. We have an inductor, a capacitor and a resistor. This is called a series LCR circuit. Is connected to an AC source. Look at the AC source here. This is the AC source voltage. And it is 200 volts. That's what they say. The voltage across the resistor, capacitor or inductor are resistor. Resistor is how much? Voltage across resistor is 200. Then across capacitor, it is 250. Across inductor also, it is 250. All right. So the voltages are given in the question. And then the algebraic sum of voltages across the three elements is greater than the voltage of the source. How is this paradox resolved? It's an important question, repeated one. We have done this in class. I'll interpret the question. We have a series LCR circuit here. Look at this. Inductor is there, capacitor is there, then resistor, inductor, capacitor, and resistor. And they are connected to a source voltage of 200 volts. 200 volts. Yeah, that's right. And as you can see, voltage across inductor is 250. Voltage across capacitor is also 250. Voltage across resistor is 200. And what they are asking is, the total voltage is 250 plus 250, 500 plus 200, 700. Isn't it greater than 200? That means what you're applying is 200 and what appears here is 700 altogether. If you add them up, that makes it 700. 250 plus 250 plus 200 is 700. So how can that be possible? Is it not a paradox? And if yes, how do you resolve this paradox? Okay, it looks like a discrepancy, right? What you're applying is only 200 and, question number 49. So the voltage applied is 200. And the voltage across inductor is 250, capacitor is 250, resistor is 200. And what do you understand looking at the picture? You know, these two voltages are same. Voltage across inductor is 250. Voltage across capacitor is also 250, which makes it what? VL equal to VC. VL equal to VC is condition number 9. I wrote 10 conditions there. So the circuit is at resonance. So I'm sure that the circuit is at resonance. So what if the circuit is at resonance? The entire applied voltage will be appearing across the resistor. So V will be equal to VR. This is the 10th point that we wrote that day, if you remember. So what is applied voltage? Or I could say VR is equal to V. VR is equal to V. So what is VR? 200, you are applying 200, right? And that is appearing across resistor. So what has happened is, this 250 and 250, they are actually out of phase, right? Because VL is what? VL is straight up, VC is straight down. They are out of phase, so they are going to cancel each other. 250 minus 250 is zero. So you can't take 250 plus 250 plus 200. Actually, it is 250 minus 250 here. Why? Because the resultant voltage is given by VC equal to VR square plus VL minus VC the whole square. Look at this. This is VL minus VC. It's not VL plus VC. So VL minus VC means 250 minus 250. They are going to get canceled with each other. Right. So that actually solves the paradox. Did you understand? So how do we answer this question? I'm putting it on record one more time. You are applying 200, but the voltage that appears here is 250. 250, 200, altogether, if you add them up, that'll give you 700. So that actually is a paradox. And how do you resolve this paradox? That is a question. What you have applied is only 200 and you're getting 700. Can that be possible? What happens here is you should say like this. Here, voltage across inductor is 250. Voltage across capacitor is also 250. That means they are equal. Both are 250. Voltage across inductor is equal to voltage across capacitor. Actually, this is a specific condition called resonance. So I would say that the circuit is at resonance. And at resonance, what happens? You should write that the VL and VC, VL and VC are out of phase. As you can see, VL is straight up, VC is straight down. So they are going to cancel each other. It is VL minus VC instead of VL plus VC. Understood? So these two voltages being out of phase, they will cancel each other. And whatever you apply, 200 will appear across this resistor. That solves the paradox. Okay. So let us move to the question. No. VR is not out of phase. VL and VC are actually out of phase with each other. VL and VC. VL is what? 90 ahead of current. VC is what? 90 behind current. So altogether it is 180. Understood? Okay. So let's move to the next question. The next part of the question. Read it, please. Just give me a second. So moving on to second part of this question. Second part of this question. Given the value of resistance R is 40 ohm, calculate the current in the circuit. You've been asked to find the current in the circuit. This is a previous board question, 3-mark question. You've been asked to find the current in the circuit. So how do you find the current? Current is always given by Ohm's law. Ohm's law says that it is V by Z. Current is V by Z. Right. But as you know, circuit is at resonance, Z can be replaced with R. Why? Z is equal to root of R square plus XL minus XC the whole square. This was the equation for impedance of the circuit, impedance. And circuit is at resonance, XL and XC are equal. What will happen? That part will vanish. So Z is what? Z is R. So for resonance, I wrote down 10 conditions in the last class. And one of those conditions is Z becomes equal to R, I is equal to V by R. What is the voltage you are applying? They say that 200 is the voltage applied and the resistance is 40. These are getting cut. You get 5 amperes. Did you understand? Moving on to question number 51. That's again a previous board question. Question number 51. Read it, please. Draw a plot showing the variation of current I as a function of angle of frequency omega of the applied AC source for the two cases of a series combination of inductance L1, capacitance C1 and resistance R1, inductance L2, capacitance C2 and resistance R2, where R2 is greater than R1. So what do they say? We have a series LCR circuit again. Read it again. Draw a plot showing variation of current as a function of angular frequency. So what all things are to be taken on y, x and x axis? Draw a plot showing variation of current as a function of angular frequency. So current again is frequency is the condition. Okay, current again is frequency. There are two circuits. One is L1 C1 R1. Second one is L2 C2 R2. So I need to draw two graphs. Right, look at this. I'm drawing two graphs. This is where omega is to be taken and this is where current is to be taken. I can draw two graphs like this, one graph like this and one graph like this. And you know, this is a graph that we already seen. Current is taken on y-axis and frequency is taken on x-axis. And this particular frequency is called resonant angle frequency or resonant frequency. Okay. And there are two graphs here. One corresponds to R1, second corresponds to R2. There are two LCR circuits. First one has L1, C1 and R1. Second one has L2, C2 and R2, where R2 is greater than R1. Tell me what, we did this in last class. R2 greater than R1 means what? I2 will be less than I1. That's common sense. Because lesser the resistance, greater is the current. Lesser the resistance, Ohm's law. Current is equal to what? Voltage by resistance. Current and resistance are inversely proportional. Inversely proportional. So lesser the value of resistance, greater the value of current. So this is greater current, no? So that must be lesser resistance. Lesser resistance is what? R1. So this should belong to R1. This should belong to R2. So we've been asked to draw the graphs here. Okay. I'm reading it again. One more time. Draw a plot showing variation of current as a function of angular frequency. So current is to be taken on y-axis. angular frequency is able to be taken on x-axis. Even frequency can be taken on x-axis. They might ask even frequency, either frequency or angular frequency on x-axis. The graph would be identical. Graphs would be identical. So there are two cases. First case is series combination of inductance, capacitance, and resistance. L1, C1, R1. Second case is L2, C2, R2, where R2 greater than R1. Underline that part. R2 greater than R1 means what? Look at this. I is equal to V by R. Ohm's law. Ohm's law. Look at that. Ohm's law. So I and R are inversely proportional. They say that R1 is less than R2, which means what? I1 will be more. Lesser the resistance, greater is the current. So, you know, current is more. This is current is more for this guy, right? Current is more. Which means what? That must be lesser resistance R1. And this graph should belong to R2. And what do they say? What do they say in the second part of the question? Write the relation between L1, C1 and L2, C2 at resonance. L1, C1 and L2, C2 at resonance. I can say omega equal to 1 by root LC. If you remember, omega is equal to 1 by root LC. So I'm writing for first case, omega is equal to 1 by root of L1, C1. Second case, omega equal to 1 by root of L2, C2. Okay. Why did I say same omega? As you can see, angular frequency is same for both. Right. Resonant frequency is same for both. Okay. So, yeah. Tell me what 1 by. So I can equate these two. 1 by root L1, C1 is equal to 1 by root L2, C2. So if you take the reciprocal and square it up, you get L1, C1 is equal to L2, C2. L1 by L2 is equal to C2 by C1. This is the required relation. Repeating one more time, they are asking you, yeah, no, resonant frequency is same for both. Resonant frequency is same for both. They are peaking at the same point, no? Resonant frequency is the same for both. So in that case, resonant frequency same means what? Omega is 1 by root L1 C1 for the first one. Omega is 1 by root L2 C2 for the second one. And if you balance, you equate them, you get 1 by root L1 C1 equal to 1 by root L2 C2. And then take the reciprocal, root L1 C1. Take the reciprocal, root L2 C2. Square it up, you get L1 C1 equal to L2 C2. And L1 by L2 is equal to C2 by C1. This is the required condition. And then there is a sub question, which one of the two would be better suited for tuning a receiver set? Which would be a better radio? Obviously the one with lesser resistance, because it has what? R1. Yesterday I told you, in the last session I told you, R1 is less, no. R1 is less means what? R1 is less means I1 is greater. Greater is the current, sharper is the curve. Sharper is the curve means that is having more quality factor, greater quality factor. I'll repeat. They are asking you, I told you, LCR circuit is basically used for what? Used for a selector circuit in a radio, selector circuit in a television, tuner circuit, acceptor circuit. There are three names for it. Selector circuit, acceptor circuit, tuner circuit, okay, in a radio or television set. And that is it. That is basically what a series LCR circuit. So, and if you look at two circuits like this, this one is obviously lesser resistance. Lesser the resistance, more is the current. More is the current means taller is the curve. Taller is the curve means sharper is the curve. Sharper is the curve means that's a better radio. We drew that in the last class, if you remember. Right, I drew four graphs like this. Which one would be the best one? The tallest curve would be the best curve. Why? That is the sharpest curve. So it can select the narrowest frequency range. That is the best radio. So the tallest current curve, or the one with least resistance would be the best one, because it will be having greatest quality factor. So how do you answer this question? You should say like R1. In the figure, R1 is less than R2. So I1 is greater than I2, which means what? This curve is sharper. First curve is sharper. That means it has greater quality factor. It should be chosen for a radio. Did you understand? Okay. Question number 37. 37. Question number 37, 38, 39, 40. Those questions in sequence. Did you take 37? Moving on to question number 37. Okay, 37 and 38 are from different sets. Okay, 37 and 40. Let's do. Ah, okay, fine. Thank you. Question number 37. A light bulb is rated 100 watts for a 220 volt supply of 50 hertz. Calculate the resistance of the bulb, the RMS current through the bulb. Okay. So a light bulb is rated for 100 watts for 220 volts. So power is given. Power is how much? 100 watts. And voltage is given 220 volts. What are we required to find? The resistance of the bulb. It's a frequently asked question. Actually, it should belong to second, third chapter. But anyway, since AC is mentioned, I've just given the tag AC. That's why it has come here. Understood? Actually, it should belong to the current, it's the chapter current electricity. Anyway, a light bulb is rated for 100 watts. Rated for 100 watts means what? Watts is the unit of power. What is the unit of power? Right. So it is actually power. And then voltage is given 220. Frequency is also given. Calculate the resistance of the bulb. And whenever this question is asked, power can be taken in three different ways. Voltage into current, Joule's law. Do you remember this? Power is equal to voltage times current. Power is equal to I square times R. Power is equal to V square over R. Whenever you are given a bulb and asked to find the resistance, never ever take these equations. You should always go for this equation. Ask me why. Why? Because voltage is a constant. Because you are applying the voltage to the bulb. I'm applying an AC voltage. The voltage is a constant. So if that is a constant, you can straight away find the relation between power and resistance. Understood? So never use I square R or V into I in the case of bulb questions in order to find the resistance of a bulb. So you better go for PC equal to V square by R. What is the equation here? Power is given by V square over R. R should come to the left side. R is equal to V square over P. So I'm cross multiplying. Tell me what you get. V square is 220 into 220 divided by P is 100 watts. So that makes it 484 ohm. That will be the resistance. And second question is to find the current through the bulb. RMS current through the bulb. RMS current. IRMS is what? That's right. IRMS is VRMS divided by resistance. Because Ohm's law says that any current is the ratio of voltage to resistance. Voltage to resistance. Frequency is given to confuse you. That won't be required. Okay. Voltage by resistance. So if you want to find the current, you just take voltage to resistance ratio. And you've been asked to find IRMS. So it should be what? VRMS over resistance. What is VRMS? VRMS is 220. How do you know if it is VRMS? Can it be V0? Can it be V average? No. Whenever a voltage is given in a numerical, I've told you at least 100 times that it would be RMS voltage because it's a measured voltage. It can only be RMS voltage. Divided by the resistance, how much? 484. So 220 by 484. This is actually 220 by 22 into 22. This and this are cut. It is 10. So the answer is 10 by 22 amps. Did you understand? Read question number 38. An alternating voltage is given by VC equal to 140 sine 314 T is connected across a pure resistor of 50 watts. Find the frequency of source, the RMS current. Pure resistor of 50 watts. Frequency of source and RMS current. Tell me how you find this. Tell me how you find this. So I've been given what? Voltage. General form is given. Voltage is 140 sine 314 T. We must have done at least 10 questions on this, right? VC equal to V is given. Tell me, Kenan. VC equal to 140 sine 314 T. Below this, write the general form. Tell me the general form, my dear. General form. What is general form? V0 sine omega T. VC equal to V0 sine omega T. So I can compare these two. What do I get if I compare? I'll get in place of omega, I have 314. Because look at this, what is the argument of sine? Argument of sine is omega t. What is argument of sine? 314 t. Or in place of omega, we have 314. So omega is 314. Omega is 2 pi into f, that is 314. So frequency would be what? 314 by 2 pi. So that would make it what? Pi and 314, it is 100. 3.14 into 100 is 314, right? So they get cut perfectly, right? 100 by 2 is what? That would make it 50. 50 hertz is frequency. So one of the questions is to find out the frequency. Second question is RMS current. Yeah, that's right. RMS current. How do you find RMS current? RMS current. Before that, I have V0 here, right? Look at that. This is V0, which is 140, right? Tell me something, please. V0. Tell me, Sean. V0 is 140, right? In place of V0. No. V0 is equal to 140. V0 is 140. Yeah, that's right. V0 is equal to 140. And if I have V0, I can find out VRMS. VRMS is what? That will come in handy later on. Okay. VRMS is V0 by root 2. So 140 by root 2. I need to find what? I need to find current, right? Current. So I can find the resistance and put it over there. There are multiple ways, but you know, this is VRMS is there, no? And then power is given. Power is 50 watts. Power is 50 watts. So I can just put it over here and find out. VRMS into IRMS is equal to, right. So what is the equation for power? VRMS into IRMS. Why don't I take cos phi here? Now did you understand, Sakina, why they have given power? You can directly use this equation, power on. This is P is equal to VRMS, IRMS into cos phi should be there. But this is what? A resistive circuit, a bulb. Bulb means what? Only the resistor is there. So cos phi is 1. Don't worry much about it. VRMS into IRMS. What is power? It is 50 watts. What is VRMS? 140 by root 2. What is IRMS to be calculated? So 0, 0 get cut. This goes there. 5 root 2 cross multiply by 14 will be IRMS. Did you understand? Next question, question number 39. We did this, but even then I'm going to do it again. Question number 39, series LCR circuit is connected to an AC source. Using the phasor diagram, derive the expression for impedance of the circuit. Plot the graph to show the variation of current with frequency of the source, explaining the nature of its variation. It's again a 5-mark question. Read it again. It's again a 5-mark question. Question number 39. A series LCR circuit is connected to an AC source. Series LCR circuit. Inductor is there, capacitor is there, resistor is there. It is connected to an AC source, as you can see, right? Series LCR circuit. Then using the phasor diagram, derive the expression for the impedance of the circuit. So you have to draw the phasor diagram. Even though we have done this 3-4 times already, I'm doing it again so that it gets imprinted in your mind. Okay, you should be able to write it from memory. Understood? So we have an inductor here, then a capacitor and a resistor. As you can see, it's a series combination, which means what? Same current flows through all the components. How many components are there? There is an inductive component, capacity component, and a resistive component, right? So all those are in series. There is only one current in the circuit, so I can simply draw one current. So current is going to be my reference vector here, okay? Unlike in the previous cases where we took voltage as reference, current, this time around we are taking current as reference. Why should I take current as reference? In that case, I need to draw it only once, because same current here, here, here. I'm drawing it here. Look at this, current is drawn here. This is current. I'm drawing current here. I need to draw current only once. Now what? Voltage across resistor can be drawn there itself. This is voltage across resistor. Why? Because in a purely resistive circuit, voltage and current are in phase. Voltage and current are in phase. See this now. Voltage and current are in phase in a purely resistive circuit. In a purely resistive circuit, voltage and current are in phase. So that is why I've drawn them along the same direction. Then I told you there is something called Eli the Iceman. Now you can use this mnemonics to learn the phase lead or phase lag here. Eli the Iceman. L stands for inductor and C stands for capacitor. And in the case of inductor, who is leading? EMF is leading. EMF comes first and current comes later, right? So EMF is leading. And in the case of capacitor, current is leading and EMF is lagging, right? So I'm looking at inductor now. EMF is leading. Leading by how much? All the time pi by 2. This is pi by 2. This is again pi by 2, right? So EMF is leading. So I'm drawing EMF from here leading. That means I should draw
VL straight up. VL should be pointed upwards. VL, right?
Inductor capacitance dependent. Inductance dominated. Are you talking about dominated inductance dominated or capacitance dominated? Yeah. Yes. You can draw either of them. No issues. You have to write at that in the beginning. VL greater than VC. In textbook, they have taken inductance dominated circuit. You could even draw VC greater than VL. So I'm sticking to this one because textbook has given this VL greater than VC. Anyway, coming to that, I'll come to that later. So in inductor, EMF is leading, current is lagging. Current is already drawn. EMF is leading by pi by 2. In capacitor, current is leading or EMF is lagging. Lagging by how much? EMF is lagging by pi by 2. Look at that. I've drawn a shorter vector this time. Tell me why. VC is smaller than VL. Why? I told you, no, it is an inductance dominated circuit. I've taken an inductance dominated circuit. Padma, do you understand? Anuja, VL and VC. Tell me, please. Okay. So this is I, this is VR. Here you have VL, here you have VC. You may even draw VC greater than VL if you want. VC greater than VL is also another option. VC can be greater than VL. But anyway, one of them has to be greater than the other one. And then what? You can take the net of these two. That would make it, this is what? This is the net of these two. VL minus VC. Then what? Complete the parallelogram. Draw the diagonal. That is how you find the resultant of vectors. Parallelogram law of vector addition. So I have one vector here, VR. I have another vector here, VL minus VC. I have to find the resultant of those two. I just complete the parallelogram. I draw the diagonal. That would be V. And this angle would be phi. Right. This is how phasor diagram is to be drawn. This is very, very important. So you can easily draw it from memory. Nothing to be learned here. Okay. So easy. You just draw the reference current first. Then voltage across resistor, because voltage and current are in phase in a purely resistive circuit. Then in a capacity circuit, current is leading or voltage is lagging by pi by 2. And in inductive circuit, EMF is leading, voltage is leading. So voltage is leading by pi by 2. I take the net of those two, VL and VC being in opposite directions will give you VL minus VC. Obviously, VL minus VC is up, straight up. Why? That is greater than this one, right? And I got VL minus VC here and VR over here, and then complete the parallelogram, draw the diagonal. That is exactly what we do when we have two vectors whose resultant is to be taken, right? So I got V here, I got phi here. They're asking you to find the impedance. So I'm doing this, VC equal to, what is V here? I can apply Pythagoras theorem. In this triangle, I can apply Pythagoras theorem. Hypotenuse is equal to what? Base square. VR square plus altitude square. Altitude is, this is altitude, right? Look at this. This is altitude. Come over here. It is VL minus VC. VL minus VC the whole square. Okay. So VC equal to root of, I can make a modification. VR is IR the whole square. Because voltage is equal to current into resistance. I wrote this in the last class. Voltage across resistance is equal to current into resistance. Voltage across inductor is equal to current into resistance. Voltage across capacitor is equal to current into resistance. Any voltage is equal to current into corresponding resistance. Okay. In the case of resistor, that is resistance. In the case of inductor, that is reactance. In the case of capacitor, that is again reactance. Okay. So voltage across resistor is I into R. Voltage across inductor is I into XL. Voltage across capacitor is I into XC. This is resistance of an inductor. This is resistance of a capacitor. It is simply Ohm's law. So I'm putting them over here. Tell me what you're going to get now. This is IXL minus IXC the whole square. So VC equal to, this is I square over here, no? And this is also I square. This is also I square. I got I square everywhere. When I take it outside square root, it becomes I into root of R square plus XL minus XC the whole square. What is V by I? I goes to denominator. V by I is called impedance. That is exactly what they have asked. Root of R square plus XL minus XC the whole square. This is how you derive the equation for impedance of the circuit. So V is equal to, I have got I square here, no, I square. Here also there is I square, I square. I've taken I square from all the terms, and when they come out of square root, they become what? I, and V is equal to I into root of R square plus XL minus XC, the whole square is my equation. And I take this I over the denominator, V by I would be a resistance. Voltage by current is a resistance. But this time around, you will call it by another name, impedance. Is it resistance actually? Root of R square plus XL minus XC the whole square. This is what? This is the impedance or the total resistance offered by inductor, capacitor and resistor together. Inductor, capacitor and resistor together. And in the last part of the question, they are asking you to draw the graph. Graph of what again is what? Plot a graph to show the variation of current with frequency. Variation of current with frequency. You know what? We have drawn it many times. Current with frequency, current with frequency, and we have to draw resonant frequency here, current with frequency. And they're asking you to explain the behavior. It's easy. You should say like current is initially increasing and at resonant frequency, current is maximum. Beyond that, frequency decreases. Did you understand? Next one is question number 47. Take it as a homework. Or mark it as done. For a given circuit, it's a 5 mark question again. Im is equal to I sine omega t. Show that average power dissipated in a resistor over a complete cycle is half Im square R. You know how to do this. Average power dissipated. Last class, we did the derivation for power. Do you remember? We write the voltage as for voltage or EMF. You better call it EMF. EMF is equal to E0 sine omega t. And then current is given by I0 sine omega t plus phi or minus phi. You can take whichever you want because it can be either an inductance dominated circuit or a capacitance dominated circuit. Okay. Whichever it is, you know, the second term is going to vanish. So that won't make much of a difference. Understood? So anyway, you multiply them so as to get the power. Power is E into I. You do a little bit of mathematical treatment. And then in the end, you are going to get power as ERMS, IRMS, cos phi. Okay. And they are particularly talking about what? Resistive circuit. Purely resistive circuit means what? Phi is equal to zero. Voltage and current are in phase. Then what? Power is equal to ERMS, E0 by root 2. IRMS, I0 by root 2. Cos zero. That is what? Root 2 into root 2, 1 by 2. Into E0 into I0. Right. What do they ask? What do they ask in the question? I need to get what? R there, no? So I can write this E0 as what? Half into I0 R into I0. That is half into I0 square R. In place of I0, they have used IM, I maximum. Repeating one more time the derivation. Why are we taking phi? I is equal to I sine omega t. Yeah, if it is I sine omega t for a given AC, IM is equal to I sine omega t, then the phase difference would be there in the EMF. Don't worry about it, Sana. Understood? Anyway, there will be a phase difference between them. So if they give this current as I0 sine omega, it doesn't matter. It doesn't make any difference, no? If you take the current as I0 sine omega t, the other one must be chosen minus phi. Understood? Anyway, there should be a phase difference between them. That's for sure. Understood? Okay, I can repeat because you may have confusions there. Question number 47 again, read it. For a given circuit, Im is equal to I sine omega t. No. It's not purely resistive circuit. Who says it's purely? Okay, purely resistive circuit. But I'm starting with the general case, phi. Then in the end, I am just putting the special case. That's it. Understood? When you do the derivation, since it's a 5 mark question, they expect you to do the derivation. Understood? It all depends on the mark distribution. If it's a 3 mark question altogether, you can directly put this equation and then substitute and find out. Understood? But since this is a 5 mark, I presume that it is a 5 mark question. So first part brings you 3 marks. In that case, you'll have to do the derivation. Understood? Do you remember this derivation that we did in the last class? Question number 47, Lakshmi, 47. Read it again. Hope you remember we did this. I spent around 15 minutes in the last session. Okay. So what exactly is the question? We are on question number 47 now. For a given AC, Im is equal to I sin omega t. So Im is equal to I sin omega t. Okay. Yeah. Im is equal to I sin omega t. And then E is equal to E0 sin omega t minus phi or plus phi. Then you do the derivation. Power is equal to voltage into current. Put the values here. Then derive. In the end, you will get this. This is the only derivation in the chapter. Okay. Power is equal to ERMS into IRMS into cos phi. And then you put, it's a purely resistive circuit that they're talking about. So purely resistive means phi will be zero. Phi will be zero. So power is E0 by root 2, I0 by root 2, cos 0. That is half into E0, I0. But they have asked you to get it in another form. You know, you don't see E0 there, right? You need to convert this E0 to the terms of resistance. Because resistance is mentioned. Voltage is what? Current into resistance. Look at the circle E0. Voltage is current into resistance. I0 into R. So I0 into I0. I0 square. Half R. Then second part of the question. Light bulb is rated at 100 watts. For a 220 volt AC supply, calculate the resistance of the bulb. We did this question already twice. Okay, that was 37 and 40. Question number 37, question number 40. Yeah, similar to 47th question, part B. So that's a home assignment for you. Did you understand? So let's do a few more questions here. Could you please take the first page? First page. All right. Question number 1 did. Question number 2 we did. Question number 3 we did. Question number 4. Read question number 4. I'll quickly read it. We have done similar question. State the condition for resonance to occur in a series LCR circuit and derive the expression for resonant frequency. State the condition for resonance to occur. What is the condition for resonance to occur? What is the condition for resonance to occur? XL is equal to XC, right? This is the condition for resonance to occur. Do you remember? Whenever the circuit has inductive and capacitive reactances equal. See this? Whenever a circuit has, series LCR circuit has inductive and capacitive resistances, I mean reactances equal, we say that the circuit is at resonance. And what is XL? L omega. What is XC? 1 by C omega. Omega goes here, L goes here. Omega square is equal to 1 by LC. Or omega will be equal to 1 by root LC. Omega is 2 pi F. 1 by root LC. Or frequency will be 1 by 2 pi goes over to the right side, making it 2 pi root of LC. Because they have asked you to derive the condition for frequency. They derive the frequency equation. Second part is draw a plot showing variation of peak current with frequency of AC source used. We have done this n number of times now, so many times. Draw a plot of variation of peak current, variation of peak current with frequency. Here it can be frequency or angle of frequency, here it is current. Okay. And then also define quality factor of a circuit. We wrote three equations for quality factor in the last session. L omega by R, 1 by C omega R, 1 by R into root of L by C. I told you this equation you might not find in school notes or in textbooks, but this will come in handy as we do when we do numericals. 1 by R into root of L by C. That's a relation connecting R, L and C. Okay, so mark the question as done. Did you understand? So we are on question number 8 now. This question has been asked only once in the last 15 years. So it's obviously not to be learned. That's what I say. But anyway, I'm doing it since it's been asked only one, at least once. The expression, derive the relationship between peak and RMS value. Peak and RMS value in an AC circuit. Derive the expression for peak and RMS value. I'll do one by one. First of all, I'll do peak and RMS, right? So peak and RMS is there. Peak and average is there. First of all, I'll do peak and average. How do you find the equation for average? You know, I'm going to write the equation for average velocity. Average velocity is given by what? Oh, I could say current is given by dq over dt. You've seen this, right? Current is given by dq by dt. This is an equation from current electricity. Current is defined as the ratio of charge to time. Current is ratio of charge to time. So I'm cross multiplying. What do I get? Dq is equal to I into dt. Now, this is a small charge flowing for a small time dt. So in such cases, our next obvious step is what? Finding the total current, total charge. How can I find the total charge?
Just integrate this guy, I into dt. I am actually finding the average over a half cycle. Look at that, this half cycle. Half cycle means t by 2. Half cycle is t by 2. Full cycle is t. So half cycle is t by 2. Okay. So I'm just integrating from 0 to t by 2. Look at that again. What am I doing here? I'm finding what? I'm finding average current. Average current. So for that, I'm taking I is equal to dq over dt. Cross multiply, I get dq is equal to I into dt. If it's a small charge, I can find the total charge just by integrating it. That's a mathematical process. If you have the small quantity, and if you want to get the whole quantity, the obvious process is integration, integration I dt. Where are you integrating from? You are integrating over a half cycle. Half cycle means 0 to t by 2. Because this point is t by 2, this point is t. Right. So I'm just putting the value here, integral 0 to t by 2. I is what? You know, in this chapter, I is I 0 sin omega t dt. Okay. I take I 0 outside. I 0 outside because it's a constant. I'm telling you the integration, you have to learn this by heart. Sin omega t dt's integration is minus cos omega t by omega. But I have done this few times in class, this integration, especially in alternating current. This chapter itself, while calculating the power, integration of sin omega t dt is minus cos omega t by omega. So I put it here, minus cos omega t by omega. From where to where? 0 to t by 2. I'm simplifying. I'm taking this omega outside. Okay. So minus is also taken outside. Minus I 0 by omega. Minus is taken outside. Omega is taken outside. Into cos of omega t. Omega is 2 pi by t. Into upper limit. That is t by 2 minus cos 0. What have I done here? I'm repeating this one more time. I've taken I 0 outside because it's a constant. What is the integration of sin omega t dt? Integration of sin omega t dt is a standard integration. Integration of sin omega t dt is minus, only half cycle is required, Maria. Full cycle it is going to be 0. Okay, full cycle it is 0. Average over a half cycle is found out here. Okay. So minus cos omega t by omega. So I put minus cos omega t by omega from 0 to t by 2. Then, you know, I'm taking this minus outside. That makes it minus I 0. Omega is also going outside. Inside I got cos omega t. So what is cos omega t? Cos, this is actually omega, 2 pi by t. 2 pi by t is omega. Then I should give the upper limit. What is upper limit? In place of small letter t, it is t by 2 minus cos of lower limit is 0. So let us cut t and t are cut, 2 and 2 are cut. You get what? Minus I 0 by omega into, this is cos pi. Cos pi is minus 1. Minus, this is cos 0, that is 1. Minus 1, minus 1, minus 2. Minus or minus? Plus. 2i0 by omega is 2 pi by t. Again, omega is 2 pi by t. So 2 and 2 are cut. Just give me a minute. Omega. Did I make any mistake? I0 is omega. Just give me a minute. 1 second. 1 second, please. Yeah, that's correct. That's correct. So what I got is charge only. I need to find current. So this is what? T goes to numerator. So I can write charge is equal to T goes there. T I 0 by pi. So what is I now? I average Q divided by T by 2. Why T by 2? I'm finding it over half cycle. So that is equal to what? That is equal to Q. T I 0 by pi by T by 2. T and T are cut. Oh, T and T are cut. 2 goes to numerator. That makes it 2 by pi I 0. That is the equation for average value of AC over a half cycle. I'll do it one more time. Don't worry. Average value. The question is to find out average value of AC over a half cycle. I'll do this once more. Look at this. I'm going to find out average value of AC over a half cycle here. Remember, over a full cycle, it's going to be zero anyway, right? Because this is plus and this is minus, that makes it zero, right? So average value of AC is what? Average value. So before that, I'll tell you integration of sine omega t dt. Integration of sine omega t dt is what? Minus cos omega t over omega. You have to learn this by heart, okay? That's a standard integration, minus cos omega t by omega, right? And I told you I'm going to find out average over half cycle only, t by 2. I'm going to find average over half cycle only. So let's come back here. I start with this equation. I is equal to dq over dt. So cross multiply, dq is equal to I into dt. I'm just cross multiplying, okay? Having obtained the small charge, I should move on to find the total charge. Total charge is what? Integral I dt. Integral I dt means I need to find the whole charge from where to where? 0 to t by 2. I'm finding it over half cycle. 0 to t by 2. So I'm just putting it one more time. 0 to t by 2. I is what? I 0 sine omega t dt. So I take this I 0 outside into what is integral sine omega t dt? I 0 outside. Integral sine omega t dt is there. What is that? Minus cos omega t by omega. I take this outside, minus outside, I 0 by omega from 0 to t by 2, right? I put it inside. Cos of omega is 2 pi by t from 0 to t by 2. Then I should give the limits. How do you give the limits? I'll keep this outside term intact. I won't touch it. Minus I 0 by omega into what? This is cos of, I forgot to put the small t there. Cos omega t is there. No, cos omega t. This is omega. Cos of 2 pi by t into upper limit. Upper limit is what? T by 2 minus lower limit. Lower limit is 0. So I'm just putting 0 there. That's it. Question number, I'll come back to that. T and T are cut. So this is minus I 0 by omega into cos of 2 and 2 are cut. Cos pi. Cos pi is minus 1. Cos 0 is 1. So this is what? Minus 1 minus. Minus 1 minus 1 minus 2. Minus 2 into minus. Plus 2 I 0 by omega is 2 pi by t again. 2 and 2 are cut. This goes to numerator, I 0 t by pi. I got the total charge. This is total charge. Now what? I need to find I average. How do you find I average? Total charge by total time. Total time is t by 2 only. So I can put it here, I 0 into t by pi divided by t by 2. This and this are cut. This goes to numerator. 2 by pi times I 0. That will be the average value of current over a half cycle. Okay. Did you understand? Moving on to question number 8 now. So there are two relations now. First relation is I average. What is I average? I average is I 0. 2 by pi I 0. I average is 2 by pi I 0. This is relation number 1. And I RMS is what? I 0 by root 2. Actually, question number 8 is to do this relation. But instead, I did this first. That's a separate question. I did this first. These can be a question. These, out of these two, they might ask one question. But like I told you, over the past 15 years, it's been asked only once. They'll ask either average current or RMS current. That particular question is on RMS current. But I did average now. Next is RMS, okay? Between RMS and peak value. Look at this. How is RMS value defined? I'll tell you. Look at this. I have a resistor here and I'm giving an AC voltage. All right. AC voltage. I'm calculating the heat generated. What is the equation for heat generated? Heat generated is given by I square RT. This is the equation for heat generated, right? I'm going to find the relation between. Let me repeat one more time. See, I have a resistor here and I'm applying an AC voltage. I'm going to find out the heat generated.
What is the equation for heat generated? It is actually given by I square RT. This is called Joule's law of heating, which you've been seeing since class 8. Class 9. Joule's law of heating, H is equal to I square RT. But here, I would better write it as H is equal to integral I square R dt. Why? Because this I is a function of time. What is the equation for I? I is written as I zero sine omega t. The equation for I contains time, which means it is time dependent. I is time dependent. I is a variable. I is not a constant. If I is a constant, you can directly take I square RT. There is nothing wrong about it. But since I is a function of time, or I keeps changing with the time, you know, I should integrate this. That is when integration comes to your help. Okay, when you have a time dependent function, when charge or current is a time dependent function, you should go for integration. Did you get my point? Repeating one more time. Heat, if you're calculating the heat, the direct equation is I square RT. But this can be applied only if the current is a constant quantity. But here current is not a constant quantity. Current is a variable. Current is a function of time. In such cases, you should integrate. So look at this, I'm integrating. This time around, you know, I'm going to calculate RMS over full cycle. Don't ask me why. RMS is always found over full cycle. So I should integrate from 0 to t, full cycle. 0 to t, this is t by 2 and full cycle is t. I'm integrating over full cycle, 0 to t. So that is equal to integral 0 to t. I is what? I 0 sine omega t the whole square now. Because I is I 0 sine omega t. I is I 0 sine omega t into r dt. So let me integrate this. I 0 square, that's a constant, can be taken outside. Then r can be taken outside. What do we have inside? Integral of sine square omega t dt from 0 to t. I told you the value of this in the last class, if you remember. If you remember, that is actually t by 2. It's a standard integration which you do in mathematics. You can learn this by heart. Trust me, you are never expected to prove this mathematical relation. You can simply put t by 2 instead. So tell me what you get now. I 0 square r into t by 2. This is the heat generated, equation number 1. But heat generated can also be written as IRMS square into RT. That is how heat generated is defined, because I'll tell you the definition of RMS current. It is that current which would produce same amount of heat as is generated by an AC over a complete cycle. You didn't understand? RMS current definition is what? It is that value of DC. That is why it is also called DC value. It is that value of DC which would produce same amount of heat as is generated by an AC over a complete cycle. So an AC over a complete cycle produces how much of heat? I've just calculated it. Okay. Same amount of heat is generated by a DC. If you look at a DC, it is I square RT direct, no? Because DC is a constant. So I can directly use my equation. And this is my second case. Now I can equate them. I got two equations for heat. So I just put them over here. IRMS square into RT is equal to, this is I zero square R T by 2. Look at this T by 2. R and R are cut. T and T are cut. IRMS square is equal to I zero square by 2, or IRMS will be I zero by root 2. That is how you do the derivation. IRMS equal to I zero by root 2. I'm doing it again. Look at this. I'm repeating. Look at this. You know, what is RMS value? I'll tell you. RMS value of AC is what? RMS value of AC is that value of DC. Okay, that is why RMS value is also called DC value of AC. DC value of AC. Why is it called DC value of AC? It's actually DC value. RMS value, you're finding an equivalent value. That's it. RMS value of AC is that value of DC, which would produce the same amount of heat as generated by an AC over a complete cycle. That means, you know, you calculate the heat generated by an AC over a complete cycle. If same amount of heat is to be generated, how much of the DC is to be applied? That is called RMS value. You didn't understand. This is one full cycle of AC. You calculate the heat generated for one full cycle. If same amount of heat is to be generated, how much of DC is to be given? That DC is called RMS value. I'm repeating the definition one more time, just in case you want to write this down. RMS value of AC is that value of DC, which would produce or which would generate same amount of heat as generated by an AC over a complete cycle. Simple. You just calculate the heat generated by an AC over a complete cycle. Heat generated by an AC over a complete cycle. Heat generated by AC over a complete cycle. If you want to produce same amount of heat, how much of DC is to be given? That is known as RMS value. So let us start with heat. What is the equation for heat? I told you I'm using integration I square RT, integration I square R dt. Why should I use integration here? Why should I use integration? Because this chapter is AC. AC current is time dependent current. Time function. It's a function of time. Yes, exactly. It's a function of time. When current keeps changing or when voltage keeps changing, you need to go for integration. Understood? Otherwise, I would have directly given it as I square RT. Why should I take I square R dt and then integrate? Because this current is not a constant. This current keeps changing. This current is a function of time. So let us put it again. Integral I is what? I zero. Integral I is what? I zero sine omega t, the whole square, into R dt. From where to where? 0 to t. Because my definition asks me to integrate from 0 to t. It is that value of DC which would produce same amount of heat as generated by an AC over a complete cycle. Complete cycle means 0 to t. Complete cycle means 0 to t. So I'm integrating. Look at this. I can take this I0 square outside. I0 square into R is taken outside. R integral. What else is remaining? 0 to t. Sin omega t square. Sin square omega t. Then dt is also there. This is a standard integral whose value is t by 2. I told you in the last session. So that makes it I0 square R into t by 2. This is heat when using AC. Now I'm going to find out heat using another equation. Instead of AC, I'm putting DC there. Tell me what. In that case, I can directly put my equation. I can put that equation as, say, I square RT. That is my direct equation, equation number 2. But both are actually heat, no? And then that is how it is defined. You can just equate them. Tell me what then. I square RT. I square RT is equal to I zero square into R into T by 2. T by 2. T and T are cut. R and R are cut. So I will be what? I will be what? Square root of this. Square root of this is what? I zero. By square root of this is what? Root 2. And this current will henceforth be called RMS current. So IRMS will be I zero by root 2. Did you understand this? Question number 16. 16 is a homework for you. 16, our market has done. A series LCR circuit is connected to an AC source having voltage V is equal to Vm sin omega t. Derive the expression for instantaneous current I and its phase relationship to apply voltage. You know this, right? We did this. Yeah. We did this many times, 3-4 times. Even today, I did this twice. Question number 17. This question won't be asked anymore, but anyway, just in case, because power factor is out of syllabus now. Obtain the condition for resonance to occur. Define power factor. Power factor is cos phi. That's it. If they ask you to define, it's simply cos phi, right? Cos of phase difference. Okay, state conditions under which it is maximum and minimum. You know what? Cos phi is maximum. Cos phi is maximum when phi is 0.
cos phi is minimum when phi is 90. Cos phi is maximum. What is the maximum value of cos phi?
1.
And that happens when phi is equal to 0. Cos phi is 1. That is the maximum value for cos phi. And minimum value of cos phi is what?
0.
And that happens when phi is 90. Yeah, sure, Slok.
I can do that. Did you understand what is maximum and minimum? Did you understand this?
Yes, cos phi is, they are asking you to identify, see, power fact, they are asking you to write.
No. You won't take minus 1. The modulus alone is taken, Sana. Right. Modulus alone. That's a very good question. Sana is asking, won't the minimum be minus 1?
No. We will be taking only magnitude. So cos phi would be 0. The maximum value for cos, they are asking power factor is what? Power factor is cos of phi. All right, Anuja. Cos phi. And cos phi would be 1. That would be the maximum value for cos phi power factor.
Yes, exactly, Slok. Power can never be negative. And then phi is equal to 0. And second case, cos phi is equal to 0 is the minimum value. And for that, phi has to be 90. Cos phi can't be minus 1 because power can never be negative. Right. Question number 24 we did in class. So I'll mark it as done. Read question number 30. 30. The peak value of EMF is E0. Write its RMS and average value over one complete cycle. We did this. You will say that even from sleep. Right. Question number 30. The peak value of EMF is E0. Write its RMS value. RMS value is what? Over complete cycle. RMS is always given over complete cycle E0 by root 2. That is 0.77. E0 by root 2. That is 0.707 E0. Tell me here. That is 70.7% of E0. Don't you remember? E0 by root 2. That's right. Good. Right. And then second part is what? Average value over a complete cycle. No. It's a 2-mark question. Average value over a complete cycle is what? For this half cycle, Maria, this half cycle it is +2 by pi E0. This half cycle it is -2 by pi E0. So what is the total over the full cycle? It is 0. +2 by pi E0 -2 by pi E0. Average for the full cycle is what? Here it is +2 by pi E0. Just give me a second. So average value over full cycle is what? +2 by pi E0 -2 by pi E0. That is 0. Did you understand?
Question number 27. I'm leaving it as a homework for you. Question number 27. We have done this in class multiple times. Show that in an AC circuit containing a pure inductor, voltage is ahead of current by pi by 2 in phase. Not 5 by 2, pi by 2 in phase. That is only inductor. Capacitor it is, current is leading by pi by 2. Did you understand that question? Read it again. Question number 27 is a home assignment for you. You have to practice that today itself. That's a frequently asked question. Many times as you check the previous papers. Question number 27. Show that in an AC circuit containing a pure inductor. Inductor, who is leading? Eli the Iceman. Do you remember? Eli the Iceman. Tell me, Michelle. Eli the Iceman. Mariam. Eli the Iceman. In inductor, EMF is leading. Current is lagging by pi by 2. Yeah, you have to do the entire derivation. Derivation, I can help you out. The derivation later on, if you want, I can send you the class as well. Okay. Otherwise, I'll do that in class, next class. Capacitor, current is leading, EMF is lagging by pi by 2. Those are the two derivations left in the chapter. Everything else was done in the last session. Okay. No. Kirchhoff's law won't be. Yeah. You can do that. Yeah.
Right. So that is how it is done. Okay. So that question is also marked as done. Question number 27 is a homework. 27, they are asking about inductive circuit. So write capacity circuit also. Homework. A, inductive. B, capacity circuit as homework. Okay. Inductive and capacity circuit. So all AC questions have been done now.
Okay. All the AC questions are done now. Now we have only transformer and AC generator left.
I'll be taking a 1 hour session for it. Okay. But when I discuss the theory, you'll be able to do all the rest of the questions. All right. All the transform, if you check them out, all the questions can be done with whatever theory we do in class. Trust me on that. Don't worry. Okay. So the chapter AC stands. No idea, Neha. Right. Chapter AC stands completed. Numerical revisions.